Here on Two Now, we begin a new series of five arena films, which will be shown on consecutive nights, on the life of one of England's greatest writers, George Orwell.
The past is a curious thing. It's with you all the time. I suppose an hour never passes without your thinking of things that happened 10 or 20 years ago. And yet most of the time, it's got no reality. It's just a set of facts you've learned, like a lot of stuff in a history book. Then, some chance sight or sound or smell, especially smell, sets you going. And the past doesn't merely come back to you. You're actually in the past. I suppose Lower Binfield was just like any other market town of about 2,000 inhabitants. It was in Oxfordshire. I keep saying was, you notice, though after all the place still exists, about 5 miles from the Thames. It lay in a bit of a valley with a low ripple of hills between itself and the Thames and higher hills behind. On top of the hills there were woods in sort of dim blue masses among which you could see a great white house with a colonnade. When you're very small, you don't look into the distance.
In this house, Roselawn in Oxfordshire, Eric Blair was brought up in the early 1900s. This series of arena films tells the story of Blair's extraordinary life and of his transformation into George Orwell, one of the most remarkable figures of 20th century literature. For Orwell was not one of those writers whose life disappeared into his work. His history is the history of the troubled times through which he lived. His story is told in his own words and in the words of those who knew him, if anyone ever did know, this remote, contradictory figure, who guarded his privacy so closely that he requested in his will that no biography of him should ever be written.
It was Orwell's request in his will that no biography should be written. Do you think he made that request because he had something to hide?
I thought that at first, as anybody would, that there might be a skeleton in the cupboard, but there weren't no skeletons in the cupboard. No, I think it's only a judgment, and there's no evidence why he said it, but just that he was really such a scrupulous writer that he didn't want any distractions from his writings. He wanted people to read his writings, and he probably modestly thought that he'd led a very ordinary life, i.e. he'd been to Eton, he'd been in the Burma police, he'd been living among tramps, he'd fought in Spain, he'd been in the Home Guard, he'd worked for the BBC, nearly got drowned in whirlpools in Scotland. I mean, he really did view his life as extremely ordinary. I mean, confusing ordinary with simple.
From a very early age, perhaps the age of 5 or 6, I knew that when I grew up I should be a writer. Between the ages of about 17 and 24, I tried to abandon this idea. But I did so with the consciousness that I was outraging my true nature, and that sooner or later I would have to settle down and write books. I was the middle child of 3, but there was a gap of 5 years on either side, and I barely saw my father before I was 8. For this, and other reasons, I was somewhat lonely, and I soon developed disagreeable mannerisms, which made me unpopular throughout my school days. I had the lonely child's habit of making up stories and holding conversations with imaginary persons, and I think from the very start my literary ambitions were mixed up with a feeling of being isolated and undervalued.
It was to Roselawn that Professor Crick, Orwell's biographer, first came with Jacintha Buddicombe, Eric Blair's childhood friend and neighbour. Our film begins here, too, with her earliest memories.
Where you see that rose bush, there was, in those days, a wire fence, and Eric was on this side of the fence in the field, standing on his head, and we were in the garden of the house the other side. He was standing on his head, and I think somebody or other said, "Why are you standing on your head?" And he said, "You're noticed more if you stand on your head than if you're right way up." And that's a remark that we've always remembered because it was so typical of Eric. the Blairs, I suppose, probably hadn't been at Roselawn very long then, and he was looking around to see who he could pick up, and he picked up us.
It always seems to be summer when I look back. I can feel the grass round me as tall as myself, and the heat coming out of the earth, and the dust in the lane, and the warm, greeny light coming through the hazel boughs. I can see the three of us trailing along, eating stuff out of the hedge, with Katie dragging at my arm and saying, "Come on, baby." I was rather an ugly little boy, butter-coloured hair which was always cropped short except for a quiff in front. I don't idealise my childhood, and unlike many people, I've no wish to be young again.
The principal thing started in his place in the home. He was lonely. If he'd had a brother, he'd have been much happier. And then there wasn't a great deal of harmony in his family, between his parents, and he grieved over that.
Mr. Blair wasn't with his family in the early years. He was still out in India when the family came back to England. That Eric, I think, had hardly seen his father at all until he was about eight or so.
He was a very reserved kind of man.
A very, very reserved sort of man. And rather the sort of children should be seen and not heard and keep off the flower beds kind of a man.
As a very small child, I used to imagine I was, say, Robin Hood, and picture myself as the hero of thrilling adventures. But quite soon my stories ceased to be narcissistic in a crude way and became more and more a mere description of what I was doing and the things I saw. For minutes at a time, this kind of thing would be running through my head. He pushed the door open and entered the room. With his right hand in his pocket, he moved across to the window, etc. This habit continued right through my non-literary years. I seemed to be making this descriptive effort almost against my will, under a kind of compulsion from outside.
Does the interest in the small boy you remember nearly 70 years ago surprise you? Did he seem to you in any way remarkable?
What, Blair? No, rather the reverse. Dull, uninteresting, unattractive. That won't do for everyone is at his fan now, but of course I only knew him as a kid. He probably became brilliant after Eton. Did he go to Oxford? No.
It's very difficult to get directly at Orwell because so many people have taken such strong and wildly different interpretations of him. Inwardly, I was aware of defending him against these kind of extreme interpretations. Or to go back to the childhood one, you see, against people who said, oh no, it's all, he wrote this polemic against his prep school, it's all in that. 1984 is all in his prep school. You know, it's nothing to do with Hitler and Stalin, it's all to do with how he was treated at prep school.
A bell rang, and we all leapt out of bed, put on a dressing gown and slippers, rushed down to the swimming bath, which was in the gymnasium, dived in, swam the length. If we couldn't swim, we just walked down the steps and submerged ourselves and up again into this cold bath, then upstairs again, got dressed, downstairs again, and paraded on the roller skating rink for Mr. Wilkes to turn up and take the PT class.
The differences between home and school were more than physical. That bump on the hard mattress on the first night of term used to give me a feeling of abrupt awakening, a feeling of, this is reality, this is what you're up against. Your home might be far from perfect, but at least it was a place ruled by love rather than by fear. At 8 years old, you were suddenly taken out of this warm nest and flung into a world of force and fraud.
What are your memories of him at the school? Was he a popular boy?
No, he was a recluse. He kept himself to himself and didn't seem to have the same sort of things to interest him as normal boys. He was much bullied on that account, and so that made him more than ever a recluse, I think.
Who ran the school? Was it a private concern?
It was really run by Mrs. Wilkes, the wife of the headmaster.
Mrs. Wilkes was nicknamed Flip, and I shall call her by that name, for I seldom think of her by any other. She was a stocky, square-built woman, hard red cheeks, a flat top to her head, prominent brows and deep-set, suspicious eyes. Although a great deal of the time she was full of false heartiness, buck up, old chap, and so forth, her eyes never lost their anxious, accusing look.
She could be charming. She was very energetic. And she could be most interesting. But if you showed signs of not having done the preparation that you were told to do the night before, for instance, learn a verse of the Bible which you could recite by heart after breakfast, and if you were called on to recite it and you couldn't do it, she got into a fury. And that's why Blair, who had a plain circular moon face and fair greasy hair, used to put extra grease on his hair so that when she pulled it, as a punishment for his not having done his prep, her hand slipped off.
This was a great abiding lesson of my boyhood. I was in a world where it was not possible for me to be good. In the study was the headmaster, nicknamed Sambo. As I sat snivelling on the edge of a chair in Sambo's study, I had a conviction of sin and folly and weakness such as I do not remember to have felt before. What about corporal punishment? Because he described beatings. Were they done in public? Was it?
Oh, no. You went into Mr. Wilkes's study and bent over a chair, and he produced a switchy cane. But it wasn't very frequent.
St. Cyprian's was an expensive and snobbish school, which was in the process of becoming more snobbish and, I imagine, more expensive. All the very rich boys were more or less undisguisedly favoured. The school still had a faint suggestion of the Victorian private academy with its parlour borders. I doubt whether Sambo ever caned any boy whose father's income was much above £2,000 a year. I did not at first understand that I was being taken at reduced fees. It was only when I was about 11 that Flip and Sambo began throwing the fact in my teeth. Over a period of 2 or 3 years, the scholarship boys were crammed with learning as cynically as a goose is crammed for Christmas. Long before I'd grasped the nature of my financial relationship with Sambo, I'd been made to understand that I was not on the same footing as most of the other boys.
So what was this little boy, Eric Blair, like? What impression did he make on you when you first saw him here?
Well, this is how I described him, writing about it a few years afterwards. Tall, pale, with his flaccid cheeks, large spatulate fingers and supercilious voice, he was one of those boys who seem born old. We often walked together over the downs in our green jerseys and corduroy breeches discussing literature, and we both won in consecutive years the inevitable Harrow History Prize. I was a stage rebel, Orwell a true one.
Was he liked, or was he reasonably popular?
Well, yes, you know, there was always something about him that people couldn't help liking him. However much he shocked them and disapproved of them and antagonized them, in nearly all cases, something shone through about him which made you want him to like you a little bit better. And you never lost your temper with him, although he was absolutely maddening.
They'd get together, the whole school, outside the gymnasium, and bay and boo at them.
Why were they hated? Because they were cleverer, or...?
Yes, I think partly jealousy, and partly... Well, they were different.
Was it an abnormally snobbish school, do you think?
Well, I think England was an abnormally snobbish country. I think the school simply reflected the pre-1914 feeling that if you weren't what was called in society, you were no one. If you weren't connected with large houses and the establishment kind of jobs, you were no one, and it was your business to get yourself made into someone as fast as possible.
Cyril, what did you talk to George about on these walks on the Downs?
Well, I think a lot of the time we talked about the books we'd been reading, and then there was our secret reading, which we enjoyed very much. We could talk about to each other. Of course, he liked these very morbid stories about mysterious plagues and illnesses. He liked the Mask of the Red Death, and he liked all Wells's imaginative stories about people from other worlds causing epidemics and pestilences. And he liked these fearful
moral, morbid moral questions like, would you drink a pint of blood to save your father?
He gave me that crucifix when he gave me Dracula. It's got the Virgin and Child on one side and the Christ on the crucifix on the other. And he gave me that, and he also gave me a clove of garlic. Mm. The clove of garlic has departed many years ago, but anyway, that's what he gave me in order to protect me from Dracula.
The following verses were composed and written by Master Eric Blair, the 11-year-old son of Mr. R.W. Blair of Roselawn, Shipley.
Oh, give me the strength of the lion, the wisdom of Reynard the fox, and then I'll hurl troops at the Germans and give them the hardest of knocks. Oh, think of the warlord's mailed fist that is striking at England today, and think of the lives that our soldiers are fearlessly throwing away. Awake, oh, you young men of England, for if, when your country's in need, you do not enlist by the thousand, you truly are cowards indeed.
How about your writing aspirations? We did start, both of us, to write poetry, and we did show it to each other, and I've got a letter. I think it must be the first known Orwell manuscript that there is, which is his criticism of a piece of poetry of mine.
What was the subject of your poem?
The Death of Lord Kitchener.
Good God.
So that takes you back to 1916. But this is what I luckily found this letter to my mother. And this is how I describe him in the letter.
Terribly interesting.
I enclose a poem I made up about Lord Kitchener a few nights ago. I know it's pretty putrid stuff, but you won't mind so much as I made it up. Well, now here we come to the end of the poem where I write, "Stern criticism, please." And then this is written in Orwell's very, very adult handwriting, quite different from most schoolboys.
It is indeed, yes.
Dashed good. Slight repetition. Scansion excellent. Meaning a little ambiguous in places. Epithets for the most part well selected. The whole thing is neat, elegant and polished. E. A. Blair.
Wonderful thing. I like it very much.
So I don't think either you or Orwell was particularly great at cricket, were you?
No, we were the stuff of second 11s at preparatory schools. But we did spend a terrible lot of time in nets like these, and I remember the very, very alarming feelings of being hemmed in while one batted and various bowlers bowled at one, including the school fast bowler. And the masters looked on to see if one was promising material, and one knew one would be found out if one was flinching.
By the social standards that prevailed about me, I was no good and could not be any good. But all the different kinds of virtue seemed to be mysteriously interconnected and to belong to much the same people. It was not only money that mattered, there was also strength, beauty, charm, athleticism, and something called guts, or character, which in reality meant the power to impose your will on others. I did not possess any of these qualities. At games, for instance, I was hopeless. I was damned. I had no money, I was weak, I was ugly, I was unpopular, I had a chronic cough, I was cowardly, I smelt. This picture, I should add, was not altogether fanciful. I was an unattractive boy. A child's belief in its own shortcomings is not much influenced by fact. Until after I'd left school for good, I continued to believe that I was preternaturally ugly. It was what my schoolfellows had told me. I had no other authority to refer to. All this was 30 years ago, and more. The question is not whether boys are still buckled into Eton collars. That kind of thing is at an end. The real question is whether it is still normal for a schoolchild to live for years amid irrational terrors and lunatic misunderstandings. And here, one is up against a very great difficulty of knowing what a child really thinks and feels. I left St. Cyprian's forever. It was the end of a winter term. With a sense of coming out from darkness into sunlight, I put on my old boy's tie as we dressed for the journey. I'd won a scholarship to Eton. At Eton, you had a room to yourself. A room which might even have a fire in it. What did you like about him? What drew you?
He was
Very good company. He's rather mature for a boy of that age. He wasn't, what shall I say, wasn't light-hearted company. His humour was always rather satirical. But it was, boys love that. And one found he's rather grown up and very splendid. And he was also very well read, even that age. He certainly had an interest in words, in language, in the English. And I remember, for instance, we had, curiously enough, as our French master for a brief period, Aldous Huxley. And very incompetent he was, but we rather loved it because of his talk, the words he used. And we would try and remember him. And Eric Blair certainly was very much interested in that sort of side.
He was less unhappy at Eton, but he always felt it wasn't a school for him. There were so many regulations. And there were things there that he felt. For instance, Huxley was a master there and was almost blind. And the boys used to tease him. Well, that worried Orwell a lot. He thought, how can anyone tease a blind man? That was just typical. See, many boys, I don't suppose, would have noticed it, would they? But he noticed it, and he felt it.
He did have this great moral courage. I mean, no one could bully Orwell. He wasn't an athlete, but people respected him. They were a little bit frightened by him, and he wasn't beaten very much. Occasionally he was, but on the whole, people let him alone. At Eton, there was no bullying from top to bottom, but in the same year group, there would be bullies. And I remember once, after prayers, walking down the corridor in college, past the various people's rooms, and as I went by, rather like a terrible gangster film, a hand reached out and yanked me into this room, and there were the bullies, two of them, just like two killers from Chicago. And they said, "Connolly, what the hell do you mean by talking so much to boys in the election above? You're sucking up to them, and you know, you spend all your time bleating poetry to Rylands." And so they then proceeded to start punishing me, you know, hitting me from one to the other. And I'd been with Orwell. He was walking just behind me. And he saw me disappear. And instead of walking on, as many sort of politic little boys would have done, he came in there. He opened the door. And when he came in, he saw the bigger of these two bullies. And he simply just went for him. He gave him one sort of terrific punch. And then yanked me out again. And then we resumed our walk down the corridor, still talking about Samuel Butler.
The truth is that kids aren't in any way poetic. They're merely savage little animals. Except that no animal is a quarter as selfish. A boy isn't interested in meadows, groves, and so forth. He never looks at a landscape, doesn't give a damn for flowers. And, unless they affect him in some way, such as being good to eat, he doesn't know one plant from another. Killing things. That's about as near to poetry as a boy gets. And yet all the while there's that peculiar intensity, the power of longing for things as you can't long when you're grown up, and the feeling that time stretches out and out in front of you, and that whatever you're doing, you could go on forever.
He wasn't terribly interested, I think, in the academic side of school life. And in a way, I felt certainly the later years, he was longing for the moment when he could get away from it. He wasn't jealous of me going to Cambridge. I don't think he wanted to go to a university. I think it's the idea that he was thwarted from going to university, I think, is quite wrong. He always talked about going back to the East.
Did he really?
Oh, yes, he was absolutely fascinated by that. He had some very early memories of it, which I think were glamorized. And that's why I think the disillusion of the East was so great.
Eric Blair left Eton at 18. Within the year, he'd enlisted with the Imperial Military Police in Burma. Meanwhile, he'd fallen in love with his childhood friend, Jacintha Buddicombe. Her rejection of him played its part in his determination to leave England.
Was he at all upset at your refusing to become engaged, or was it just something slightly playful?
I don't really know whether he was upset or not. He seemed And partly from the letter that he wrote centuries later, when he wrote to me only a few months before he died, he seemed to remember all about it. And of course, going off to Burma by yes. himself, he might have been more upset about it than ever would occur to me. You see, I never took him seriously, not not from a romantic point of view.
In Moulmein, in Lower Burma, I was hated by large numbers of people, the only time in my life that I've been important enough for this to happen to me. I was subdivisional police officer of the town, and in an aimless, petty kind of way, anti-European feeling was very bitter. No one had the guts to raise a riot, but if a European woman went through the bazaars alone, someone would probably spit Betelgeuse over her dress. As a police officer, I was an obvious target, and was baited whenever it seemed safe to do so. Why did he go into the Burma police? It's a mystery, isn't it?
It's a mystery to me, and it's a mystery to his father, who wanted him to go into the ICS,
the
Indian Civil Service, which he could have done with the greatest of ease. He's a great classical scholar, and he would have got in very, very easily.
So why did he choose the Burma police, which is an outpost, a grim job, isn't it?
A grim job in a real outpost, not like India, you see.
Why did he do that?
I don't know. I don't think anybody does know. And I don't think he really knew, except he wanted to get away from it all. This is my feeling.
When a nimble Burman tripped me up on the football field and the referee, another Burman, looked the other way, the crowd yelled with hideous laughter. This happened more than once. In the end, the sneering, low faces of young men that met me everywhere, the insults hooted after me when I was at a safe distance, got badly on my nerves. The young Buddhist priests were the worst of all. There were several thousands of them in the town, and none of them seemed to have anything to do except stand on street corners and jeer at Europeans.
He couldn't stand the Buddhist monks, because they were all very political. It's the only part of the Far East where Buddhism is political. It's in Burma.
It sounds from his books as if he was pro the national population, but what you remember was him being anti.
Anti, he was very anti, yes, in this way, this is so. Because nobody could deny that the British administration was first class.
You felt he was pro the British administration?
He thought we ought not to be there, but he was pro what we had done for the country.
It is a stifling, stultifying world in which to live. A world in which every word and every thought is censored. In England, it's hard even to imagine such an atmosphere. Everyone's free in England. But even friendship can hardly exist when every white man is a cog in the wheels of despotism. You're free to be a drunkard, an idler, a coward, a backbiter, a fornicator, but you are not free to think for yourself. Your opinion on every subject of any conceivable importance is dictated for you by the Pukka Sahib's code.
And then, of course, in Burma, he was very lonely. There was no one worthy of him to talk to. He was rather isolated among the whiskey-drinking, rather, you know, usual Indian bosses. And he never made friends much in India. In Burma, rather, he was pretty lonely.
In the end, the secrecy of your revolt poisons you like a secret disease. Your whole life is a life of lies. Year after year, you sit in Kipling-haunted little clubs, whiskey to the right of you, Pinken to the left of you, listening and eagerly agreeing while Colonel Bodger develops his theory that these bloody nationalists should be boiled in oil. You hear your Oriental friends called greasy little baboos, and you admit dutifully that they are greasy little baboos. You see louts fresh from school kicking grey-haired servants. The time comes when you burn with hatred of your own countrymen, when you long for a native rising to drown their empire in blood.
On the other hand, you see Chris Hollis, who was at Eton with him and went and dined with him in Burma, in Rangoon. he found him extraordinarily sort of cheerful as a Bengal policeman. And when he talked about it, he spoke of it with great appreciation. And actually, because if you take Burmese Days, the hero is the sahib, isn't he? And I mean, the natives compare very poorly with this sahib. So that, again, he was anti-imperialist, but it was something that he appreciated, imperialism, and I think he thoroughly enjoyed himself in Burma.
You did disagree with him about a lot of intellectual things, didn't you?
Yes.
Your friendship. What was it?
I can't really remember now what it was we used to disagree about. I was, at any rate, I believed in the white man's burden and all that kind of thing. And it was a true thing. It's a silly wording it, but we only have to look at what has happened to all these countries that have been given their freedom and what's gone wrong in the process. And under European rule, includes French or Spanish or whatever it might be, the locals knew what they could do, what they could not do, and then they would get justice.
It was about 40 yards to the gallows. I watched the bare brown back of the prisoner marching in front of me. He walked clumsily with his bound arms, but quite steadily with that bobbing gait of the Indian who never straightens his knees. At each step his muscles slid neatly into place. The lock of hair on his scalp danced up and down. His feet printed themselves on the wet gravel. And once, in spite of the men who gripped him by each shoulder, he stepped slightly aside to avoid a puddle on the path. It's curious, but till that moment, I had never realized what it means to destroy a healthy, conscious man. When I saw the prisoner step aside to avoid the puddle, I saw the mystery, the unspeakable wrongness of cutting a life short when it is in full tide. This man was not dying. He was alive, just as we were alive. All the organs of his body were working. He and we were a party of men walking together, seeing, hearing, feeling, understanding the same world. And in 2 minutes, with a sudden snap, one of us would be gone.
Yes, he mentioned that. That was one of the initiations they had to go through when they first went there as cadets. And they all went through that. And so it didn't refer to him in particular. It was, a sort of standard thing.
They all had to see a man hanged?
Yeah, well, if there was one available. Some murderer or other, you said dacoit or something of that kind, had been condemned, and they had to, a cadet had to be there. There had to be a police officer there in any case. And the cadets were always assigned to that kind of thing.
And did he talk to you about the particular incident that essay is based on?
No, not really. He really didn't want to talk about it.
It's a very powerful essay, and some people have said that it's a piece of fiction rather than a piece of practical experience. You seem to be saying it's something that happened to him.
Oh, yes, definitely.
At a word from Francis, the two warders, gripping the prisoner more closely than ever, half led, half pushed him to the gallows and helped him clumsily up the ladder. Then the hangman climbed up and fixed the rope round the prisoner's neck. We looked at the lashed, hooded man on the drop and listened to his cries, each cry another second of life. The same thought was in all our minds. Oh, kill him quickly. Get it over. Stop that abominable noise.
So when he came home on leave, he decided he just couldn't go back. His father was very disappointed and looked upon him as a sort of failure. And he felt that deeply. But his mother and I were very good friends. And she said to me, Eric loves his father far more than he loves me. And I said, no, I don't think he does. It is that he wants his father to acknowledge him as a successful son, a son who couldn't make money for old Mr. Blair's concept, was not the right sort of son.
By the time of his return from Burma in 1927, The Blair family had moved to Southwold in Suffolk. What brought them there?
Oh, I think a mixture of seeking for a genteel and a reasonably cheap retiring place. Southwold began to develop from a fishing village just before and then quite rapidly after the First World War as a very favoured retiring place of, shall we say, the lesser middling top ranks of the old Anglo-Indian civil servants. If you remember Orwell's remark that his parents were of the lower, upper middle classes, which he precisely defined as the middle classes without money, this would be very much the kind of place they would come to, a kind of small-scale Bournemouth or Eastbourne.
Do you think they fitted in easily here?
It's very difficult to know. I think these Anglo-Indians fitted in with themselves. I think the villagers and the fishermen gradually came to accept them. Old man Blair doesn't seem to have fitted in. He joined the Constitutional Club, that must have been a fairly, you know, the more substantial shopkeeper's kind of place. He probably felt himself a bit above that, but on the other hand, it was the best there was. He wasn't a mixer, and he was pretty old. Mrs. Blair was a gay and vigorous bridge player and whist drive organiser, and certainly was out and about the town, but I imagine very much with those other kind of ladies.
Can I ask you both whether you remember George Orwell from your youth here in Southwold?
I remember him very well, but really sort of more to look at, and I mean he used to be in places, but he was very shy and quiet and, you know, did sort of become jolly with us all. I think he was thinking of thoughts.
He didn't join in parties, did
no,
he?
No.
He had individual friends.
Yes. Yes, he was like that.
He used to walk along the River Orwell, especially, which he loved. That's why he took the name Orwell.
And the marshes he loved. He loved everything to do with that kind of thing. And he was always awfully nice, you know, very nice, nice manners, and very quiet, gentle. But, of course, he never looked like an Eton scholar, did he?
No, he looked rather like a tramp always.
Yes.
But he was just that little bit above ordinary people,
yes,
like myself.
And myself.
Was he striking looking?
Very tall and lanky. He had an awfully nice face, you know.
But well, nothing, yes, a gentle, kind face.
Not good looking at all.
And you remember that his sleeves were always up here, didn't
yes,
you?
Yes,
he'd grown
very
out of his
bony
sleeves.
Wrists, and yes, as though he'd grown out of his clothes, but he couldn't have looked like that in Eton.
No, he had to conform there.
I suppose he was having holidays.
What was the family like? Did they join in much in the life of the town?
Yes, in a quiet way, Mrs. did.
Yes,
much.
Mrs. Blair was a bridge player, and we had a club then which she used to run. And
the father was very natty and tidy and...
Yes, with a buttonhole.
Always with a buttonhole.
I get the impression he was quite an awkward man. Some people are giving me the impression he wasn't very forthcoming, quite reserved.
Old Mr. Blair.
Old Mr. Blair.
Well, he may be, but that didn't come our way, or did he?
No, but I remember Dennis, my brother, saying that when he went to the club, he just sat there looking out, didn't join in the conversation. He told me that the other day. He just sat there sort of looking to space.
Yes.
Nice looking old man.
Did Blair get on with his parents? There must have been some tensions.
I should think there was quite a lot. But I think, that, you know, he came back and...
Yes, they accepted it. It was always his home.
But of course he was very much a socialist.
And he gave up his job, which wasn't very well thought of in those days, you know. One's parents put one in something, one was expected to stay, but he came home.
I think they were disappointed.
Disappointed more than anything.
That he came back from Burma.
Yes.
Yes.
In the spring of 1928, disenchanted with Southwold and disillusioned with English middle-class life, Eric Blair came to Paris to visit his aunt, Nellie Limousin. We know almost nothing of his life in Paris, except what he later chose to tell us about in his first published book. We do know, though, that he was now set on becoming a writer. that he gave English lessons, and that he found lodgings here at 6 Rue du Pot de Fer, once a working-class district in the 5th arrondissement. In the late autumn of 1929, he found himself short of money.
The Hotel X was a vast, grandiose place with a classical facade. I waited, and presently the chef du personnel, a sort of assistant manager, arrived and began to question me. He asked whether I was an experienced dishwasher, and I said that I was. He glanced at my hands and saw that I was lying, but on hearing that I was an Englishman, he changed his tone and engaged me. It was amusing to look around the filthy little scullery and think that only a double door was between us and the dining room. There sat the customers in all their splendour, spotless tablecloth, bowls of flowers, mirrors and gilt cornices and painted cherubim. And here, just a few feet away, us, in our disgusting filth. It is an instructive sight to see a waiter going into a hotel dining room. As he passes the door, a sudden change comes over him. The set of his shoulders alters. All the dirt and hurry and irritation have dropped off in an instant. He glides over the carpet with solemn, priest-like air. I remember our assistant maître d'hôtel, a fiery Italian, pausing at the dining room door to address an apprentice who'd broken a bottle of wine. "Do you call yourself a waiter, you young bastard? You're not fit to scrub floors in the brothel your mother came from." Words failing him, he turned to the door and, as he opened it, farted loudly, a favourite Italian insult. Then he entered the dining room and sailed across it, dish in hand, graceful as a swan. 10 seconds later, he was bowing reverently to a customer, and you could not help thinking, as you saw him bow and smile with that benign smile of a trained waiter, that the customer was put to shame by having such an aristocrat to serve it. The waiter is proud, in a way, of his skill, but his skill is chiefly in being servile. His work gives him the mentality, not of a workman, but of a snob. He lives perpetually in the sight of rich people. He stands at their tables, listens to their conversations, sucks up to them with smiles and discreet little jokes. He has the pleasure of spending money by proxy. Moreover, there's always the chance that he may become rich himself. Between constantly seeing money and hoping to get it, the waiter comes to identify himself to some extent with his employers. He will take pains to serve a meal in style because he thinks he's participating in the meal itself. The moral is, never be sorry for a waiter. Sometimes when you sit in a restaurant still stuffing yourself half an hour after closing time, you feel that the tired waiter at your side must surely be despising you. But he is not. He's not thinking, as he looks at you, what an overfed lout. He's thinking, one day, when I've saved enough money, I shall be able to imitate that man. He's ministering to a kind of pleasure he thoroughly understands and admires. And that is why waiters are seldom socialists, have no effective trade union, and will work 12 hours a day, 7 days a week. They're snobs, and they find the servile nature of their work rather congenial.
During his 2 years in Paris, Orwell's new companions introduced him to a level of life and of poverty that he had never known before. Here he associated with tramps and derelicts, the outcasts of society. On his return to England and Southwold, he was to continue his quest to know and understand such people better. In order to do this, he started to dress as they did. He called it tramping.
He began tramping in London, down the Mile End Road in the footsteps, very literally, of Jack London, but he kept the habit up even when he took rests, I nearly said in his holidays, but of course he was just writing all the time then. He hadn't got a job, but from time to time he would totter back from London to have undisturbed quiet at home, writing and 3 square meals a day cooked by his mum, that kind of thing. But he did go off tramping from here.
To sell my clothes, I went down into Lambeth, where the people are poor and there are a lot of rag shops. At the first shop I tried, the proprietor was polite but unhelpful. At the second, he was rude. The third, he was stone deaf, or pretended to be so. I explained I wanted some older clothes. "What about the money?" I said, hoping for a pound. He pursed his lips and produced a shilling. I didn't argue. I was going to argue, but I saw that I was helpless. The clothes were a coat, once dark brown, a pair of black dungaree trousers, a scarf, and a cloth cap. They were the sort of clothes you see on a bootlace seller or a tramp. An hour later, in Lambeth, I saw a hangdog man, obviously a tramp, coming towards me. And when I looked again, it was myself, reflected in a shop window. The dirt was plastering my face already. Dressed as I was half afraid the police might arrest me as a vagabond. My new clothes had put me instantly into a new world. Everyone's demeanour seemed to have changed abruptly. I helped a hawker pick up a barrow that he'd upset. "Thanks, mate," he said with a grin. No one had called me mate before in my life. It was the clothes which had done it.
I don't think he ever really lagged for money, even when he wrote Down and Out in London and Paris, because he was always, most sailors like to know, a good payer. I mean, we never had any financial trouble with him of any sort over the years. In sickness and in his more robust days, he disappeared from time to time, of course, and I think it was to do writing. He loved writing. He'd write anything for the sake of writing. But we never looked upon him then as a writer. And, of course, I think he rather upset the old girls of the town, because in London and Paris he mentioned his association with homosexuals, and it was very taboo, naturally. We made him a lot of flannel trousers over the years. In those days, I've got a record here, actually, where he paid 32 and 6 per pair of West of England trousers. Almost a working man's weekly wage.
He just turned up at home in his tramp's clothes. At my home. Much the amusement of the family who thought it was a frightful joke.
Was he ordered to have a bath instantly?
Yes, I said, you go and have a bath. I'd like to sort of feel he might shock you, you know, but of course he wouldn't get shocked at all. Well, I thought it was very unnecessary, but...
From your impression of him, he'd always wanted to be a writer.
Oh, yes, he was. From when I knew him, yes. I think he'd have told me, I'm not sure. I wouldn't be sure of that, but I'm quite sure he... And writing was the one thing through his life. Absolutely nothing came in the way of his writing.
Not even people?
No, certainly not people. Not his family or anybody else, no.
He used to sit down at 9 o'clock in a little back room with a table and writing things, and he used to write till 12. At 12 o'clock he'd throw everything down and go out and have a beer. Well, it didn't matter what he wrote as long as he wrote. He was forcing himself to write.
I want to set down some general remarks about tramps. When one comes to think of it, tramps are a queer product. Tens of thousands in number, marching up and down England like so many wandering Jews. In childhood, we've been taught tramps are blackguards, and consequently, there exists in our minds a sort of ideal or typical tramp, a repulsive, dangerous creature who'd die rather than work and wants nothing but to beg, drink, and rob hen houses. This tramp monster is no truer to life than the sinister Chinaman of the magazine stories. Why do tramps exist at all? It's a curious thing, but very few people know what makes a tramp take to the road. A tramp tramps not because he likes it, but for the same reason as a car keeps to the left. A destitute man, if he's not supported by the parish, can only get relief at the casual wards. Very little of the tramp monster will survive inquiry. A casual ward will often admit 100 tramps in one night, and these are handled by a staff of 3 porters. 100 ruffians could not be controlled by 3 unarmed men. It follows, then, that the serve-them-damn-well-right attitude that's normally taken towards tramps is no fairer than it would be towards cripples or invalids. When one has realised that, one begins to put oneself in a tramp's place and understand what his life is like.
He left the manuscript in my house. And he said, oh, take off the paper clips, but throw away the manuscript. And I thought, this is nonsense. It had been rejected by 3 publishers. So I took it to an agent in the Strand, Moore and Christie. And I said to Mr. Moore, will you read this and publish this? This is a good book. No, said Mr. Moore, I couldn't possibly. No one's ever heard of your friend. When we couldn't possibly take the risk of publishing it. So I bullied that man, and I left it with him, and I said, now you read it. And 3 months after, he sold it to Goldamps, and it came out. And on the day it came out, Orwell got £30.
What I feel the book represents is an enormous struggle to become a writer. After all, he told me that he wrote the whole of Down and Out 5 times from beginning to end. The final version was the 5th version. It took him about 3 years of really quite agonizing effort. And in the end, I think he was just looking for material and exercising his wit. I think that his sense of the droll and his keen observer's eye, what I think Mr. Pritchett called the dilatory eye, comes through in that book, and that makes it a work of literature. After all, that really is the essence of his sociological writings, that they are literary works.
Ginger and I went to a kip in Tooley Street, owned by Lou Levy, who owns the one in Westminster Bridge Road. It's only sevenpence a night, and it's probably the best sevenpenny one in London. There are bugs in the beds, but not many, and the kitchens, though dark and dirty, are convenient with abundant fires and hot water. The lodgers are a pretty low lot, mostly Irish unskilled labourers and out of work at that. We met some queer types among them.
It still is essentially a common lodging house, or whatever you'd call it.
Yes, basically it is very much that, a common lodging house, yes.
How much does it cost for somebody to spend the night here?
It's at the moment £2.15 per night. And that is actually cheaper than other places.
But the conditions he talks about in Down and Out, what life is like for homeless people looking for a place in London, have they changed?
No, they haven't. It's got worse in terms of more people being down and out in London, fighting for less resources. The conditions inside the inside buildings like this, inside the residential hostels, have changed, obviously, in terms of the conditions that they live in. But outside, essentially, no.
At 6, we went to a Salvation Army shelter. We couldn't book beds till 8, and it wasn't certain that there would be any vacant. But an official who called us brother let us in on condition that we pay for 2 cups of tea. The main hall of the shelter was a great whitewashed barn of a place, oppressively clean. On a wall, pictures of General Booth and notices prohibiting cooking, drinking, spitting, swearing, quarrelling and gambling. Any man found gambling or playing cards would be expelled and would not be admitted under any circumstances. To my eyes, these Salvation Army shelters, though clean, are far drearier than the worst of the common lodging houses. There's such a hopelessness about some of the people there. Decent, broken-down types who've pawned their collars but still try for office jobs.
I think it stands up as a document. Of course, it is partly fiction. Indeed, as Orwell was such an autobiographical writer, one could say that there was an element of fiction in all his autobiography, and a strong element of autobiography in all his fiction, because in actual fact, the Down and Out covers only a few weeks in his life in Paris, and it's still a mystery. What did he do during his 2 years in Paris? One knows that he gave English lessons. He's never written about that. One knows that he tried unsuccessfully to write 2 long novels. He's never written about that. So, taken as fiction, I think it stands up. I'm all the time surprised by the way in which the young of today, even school children, read it with such pleasure.
My story ends here. It's a fairly trivial story, and I can only hope it's been interesting in the same way as a travel diary is interesting. I can at least say, here's the world that awaits you if you're ever penniless. Someday, I want to explore that world more thoroughly. I should like to understand what really goes on in the souls of plongeurs and tramps and embankment sleepers. At present, I do not feel I have seen more than the fringe of poverty. Still, I can point to 1 or 2 things I've definitely learned by being hard up. I shall never again think that all tramps are drunken scoundrels, nor expect a beggar to be grateful when I give him a penny. nor be surprised if men out of work lack energy, nor subscribe to the Salvation Army, nor pawn my clothes, nor refuse a handbill, nor enjoy a meal at a smart restaurant. That is a beginning.
During his 2 years in Paris, Orwell's new companions introduced him to a level of life and of poverty that he had never known before. Here he associated with tramps and derelicts, the outcasts of society. On his return to England and Southwold, he was to continue his quest to know and understand such people better. In order to do this, he started to dress as they did. He called it tramping.
He began tramping in London down the Mile End Road in the footsteps, very literally, of Jack London. But he kept the habit up even when he took rests, I nearly said in his holidays. But of course he was just writing all the time then. He hadn't got a job. But from time to time he would totter back from London to have undisturbed quiet at home writing and 3 square meals a day cooked by his mum, that kind of thing. But he did go off tramping from here.
To sell my clothes, I went down into Lambeth, where the people are poor and there are a lot of rag shops. At the first shop I tried, the proprietor was polite but unhelpful. At the second, he was rude. The third, he was stone deaf, or pretended to be so. I explained I wanted some older clothes. "What about the money?" I said, hoping for a pound. He pursed his lips and produced a shilling. I didn't argue. I was going to argue, but I saw that I was helpless. The clothes were a coat, once dark brown, a pair of black dungaree trousers, a scarf and a cloth cap. They were the sort of clothes you see on a bootlace seller or a tramp. An hour later, in Lambeth, I saw a hangdog man, obviously a tramp, coming towards me. And when I looked again, it was myself, reflected in a shop window. The dirt was plastering my face already. Dressed as I was half afraid the police might arrest me as a vagabond. My new clothes had put me instantly into a new world. Everyone's demeanour seemed to have changed abruptly. I helped a hawker pick up a barrow that he'd upset. "Thanks, mate," he said with a grin. No one had called me mate before in my life. It was the clothes which had done it.
I don't think he ever really lagged for money, even when he wrote Down and Out in London and Paris, because he was always... most sailors like to know a good payer. I mean, we never had any financial trouble with him of any sort over the years. In sickness and in his more robust days, he disappeared from time to time, of course. And I think it was to do writing. He loved writing. He'd write anything for the sake of writing. But we never looked upon him then as a writer. And, of course, I think he rather upset the old girls of the town, because in London...
Dashed good. Slight repetition. Scansion excellent. Meaning a little ambiguous in places. Epithets, for the most part, well selected. The whole thing is neat, elegant and polished. E. A. Blair.
Wonderful thing. I like it very much.
No, we were the stuff of second 11s at comparative schools. But we did spend a terrible lot of time in nets like these, and I remember the
very, very alarming feelings of being hemmed in while one batted and various bowlers bowled at one, including the school fast bowler. And the masters looked on to see if one was promising material, and one knew one would be found out if one was flinching.
By the social standards that prevailed about me, I was no good and could not be any good. But all the different kinds of virtue seemed to be mysteriously interconnected and to belong to much the same people. It was not only money that mattered, there was also strength, beauty, charm, athleticism, and something called guts, or character, which in reality meant the power to impose your will on others. I did not possess any of these qualities. At games, for instance, I was hopeless. I was damned. I had no money, I was weak, I was ugly, I was unpopular, I had a chronic cough, I was cowardly, I smelt. This picture, I should add, was not altogether fanciful. I was an unattractive boy. A child's belief in its own shortcomings is not much influenced by fact. Until after I'd left school for good, I continued to believe that I was preternaturally ugly. It was what my schoolfellows had told me. I had no other authority to refer to. All this was 30 years ago, and more. The question is not whether boys are still buckled into Eton collars. That kind of thing is at an end. The real question is whether it is still normal for a schoolchild to live for years amid irrational terrors and lunatic misunderstandings. And here, one is up against a very great difficulty of knowing what a child really thinks and feels. I left St. Cyprian's forever. It was the end of a winter term. With a sense of coming out from darkness into sunlight, I put on my old boy's tie as we dressed for the journey. I'd won a scholarship to Eton. At Eton, you had a room to yourself, a room which might even have a fire in it. What did you like about him? What drew you?
He was very good company. He was rather mature for about that age. He wasn't, what shall I say, wasn't light-hearted company.
We did show it to each other, and I've got a letter. I think it must be the first known Orwell manuscript that there is, which is his criticism of a piece of poetry of mine.
What was the subject of your poem?
The Death of Lord Kitchener.
Good God.
So that takes you back to 1916. But this is what I luckily found this letter to my mother, and this is how I describe him in the letter.
Terribly interesting.
I enclose a poem I made up about Lord Kitchener a few nights ago. I know it's pretty putrid stuff, but you won't mind so much as I made it up. Well, now here we come to the end of the poem where I write, "Stern criticism, please." And then this is written in Orwell's very, very adult handwriting, quite different from most schoolboys.
It is indeed, yes.
"Dashed good. Slight repetition. Scansion excellent. Meaning a little ambiguous in places. Epithets for the most part well selected. The whole thing is neat, elegant and polished. E. A. Blair."
Wonderful thing. I like it very much.
No, we were the stuff of second 11s at preparatory schools. But we did spend a terrible lot of time in nets like these, and I remember the very, very alarming feelings of being hemmed in while one batted and various bowlers bowled at one, including the school fast bowler. And the masters looked on to see if one was promising material, and one knew one would be found out if one was flinching.
By the social standards that prevailed about me, I was no good and could not be any good. But all the different kinds of virtue seemed to be mysteriously interconnected and to belong to much the same people. It was not only money that mattered, there was also strength, beauty, charm, athleticism, and something called guts, or character, which in reality meant the power to impose your will on others. I did not possess any of these qualities. At games, for instance, I was hopeless. I was damned. I had no money, I was weak, I was ugly, I was unpopular, I had a chronic cough, I was cowardly, I smelt. This picture, I should add, was not altogether fanciful. I was an unattractive boy. A child's belief in its own shortcomings is not much influenced by fact. Until after I'd left school for good, I continued to believe that I was preternaturally ugly. It was what my schoolfellows had told me. I had no other authority to refer to. All this was 30 years ago, and more. The question is not whether boys are still buckled into Eton.
Good, but there weren't no skeletons in the cupboard. I think it's only a judgment, and there's no evidence why he said it, but just that he was really such a scrupulous writer that he didn't want any distractions from his writings. He wanted people to read his writings, and he probably modestly thought that he'd led a very ordinary life, i.e. he'd been to Eton, he'd been in the Burma police, he'd been living among tramps, he'd fought in Spain, he'd been in the Home Guard, he'd worked for the BBC, nearly got drowned in whirlpools in Scotland. I mean, he really did view his life as extremely ordinary, and confusing ordinary with simple.
From a very early age, perhaps the age of 5 or 6, I knew that when I grew up I should be a writer. Between the ages of about 17 and 24, I tried to abandon this idea, but I did so with the consciousness that I was outraging my true nature, and that sooner or later I would have to settle down and write books. I was the middle child of 3, but there was a gap of 5 years on either side, and I barely saw my father before I was 8. For this and other reasons, I was somewhat lonely, and I soon developed disagreeable mannerisms, which made me unpopular throughout my school days. I had the lonely child's habit of making up stories and holding conversations with imaginary persons, and I think from the very start my literary ambitions were mixed up with a feeling of being isolated and undervalued.
It was to Roselawn that Professor Crick, Orwell's biographer, first came with Jacintha Buddicombe, Eric Blair's childhood friend and neighbour. Our film begins here too, with her earliest memories.
Where you see that rose bush, there was, in those days, a wire fence, and Eric was on this side of the fence in the field, standing on his head, and we were in the garden of the house the other side. He was standing on his head, and I think somebody or other said, why are you standing on your head? And he said, you're noticed more if you stand on your head than if you're right way up. And that's a remark that we've always remembered, because it was so typical of Eric. The Blairs, I suppose, probably hadn't been at Roselawn very long then, and he was looking around to see who he could pick up, and he picked up us.
It always seems to be summer when I look back. I can feel the grass round me as tall as myself, and the heat coming out of the earth, and the dust in the lane, and the warm, greeny light coming through the hazel boughs. I can see the three of us trailing along, eating stuff out of the hedge, with Katie dragging at my arm and saying, come on, baby. I was rather an ugly little boy, butter-coloured hair which was always cropped short except for a quiff in front. I don't idealise my childhood, and unlike many people, I've no wish to be young again.
The principal thing started.
He felt himself a bit above that, but on the other hand, it was the best there was. He wasn't a mixer, and he was pretty old. Mrs. Blair was a gay and vigorous bridge player and whist drive organiser, and certainly was out and about the town, but I imagine very much with those other kind of ladies.
Can I ask you both whether you remember George Orwell from your youth here in Southwold?
I remember him very well, but really sort of more to look at, and I mean, he used to be in places, but he was very shy and quiet, and, you know, did sort of become jolly with us all. I think he was thinking of thoughts.
He didn't join in parties, did he?
No.
He had individual friends.
Yes, he was like that.
He used to walk along the River Orwell, especially, which he loved. That's why he took the name Orwell.
And the marshes, he loved. He loved everything to do with that kind of thing. And he was always awfully nice, you know, very nice manners, and very quiet, gentle. But, of course, he never looked like an Eton scholar, did he?
No, he looked rather like a tramp always.
Yes.
But he was just that little bit above ordinary people, yes, like myself.
And myself.
Was he striking looking?
Very tall and lanky. He had an awfully nice face, you know.
But well, nothing, yes, a gentle, kind face.
Not good looking at all. And you remember that his sleeves were always up here, didn't
yes,
you?
Yes, and grown out of his bony sleeves. Wrists, and yes, as though he'd grown out of his clothes. But he couldn't have looked like that at Eton.
No, he had to conform there.
I suppose he was having holidays.
What was the family like? Did they join in much in the life of the town?
Yes, in a quiet way, but Mrs. did.
Yes,
much.
Mrs. Blair was a bridge player, and we had a club then which she used to run. And
the father was very natty and tidy and
yes, with a buttonhole.
Always with a buttonhole.
I get the impression he was quite an awkward man. Some people have given me the impression he wasn't very forthcoming, quite reserved.
Old Mr. Blair. Well, he maybe that didn't come our way, or did he?
No, but I remember Dennis, my brother, saying that when he went to the club, he just sat there looking out, didn't join in the conversation. He told me that the other day. He just sat there sort of looking to space.
Yes.
Nice looking old man.
Did Blair get on with his parents? There must have been some tensions.
I should think there was quite a lot. But I think, that, you know, he came back and...
Yes, they accepted it was always his home.
But of course he was very much a socialist.
And he gave up his job.
More people being down and out in London, fighting for less resources. The conditions inside the inside buildings like this, inside the residential hostels, have changed, obviously, in terms of the conditions that they live in. But outside, essentially, no.
At six, we went to a Salvation Army shelter. We couldn't book beds till eight, and it wasn't certain that there would be any vacant. But an official who called us brother let us in on condition that we pay for two cups of tea. The main hall of the shelter was a great whitewashed barn of a place, oppressively clean. On a wall, pictures of General Booth and notices prohibiting cooking, drinking, spitting, swearing, quarrelling and gambling. Any man found gambling or playing cards would be expelled and would not be admitted under any circumstances. To my eyes, these Salvation Army shelters, though clean, are far drearier than the worst of the common lodging houses. There's such a hopelessness about some of the people there. Decent, broken-down types who've pawned their collars, but still try for office jobs.
I think it stands up as a document. Of course, it is partly fiction. Indeed, as Orwell was such an autobiographical writer, one could say that there was an element of fiction in all his autobiography and a strong element of autobiography in all his fiction. Because in actual fact, the Down and Out covers only a few weeks in his life in Paris, and it's still a mystery. What did he do during his 2 years in Paris? One knows that he gave English lessons. He's never written about that. One knows that he tried unsuccessfully to write two long novels. He's never written about that. So... taken as fiction, I think it stands up. I'm all the time surprised by the way in which the young of today, even school children, read it with such pleasure.
My story ends here. It's a fairly trivial story, and I can only hope it's been interesting in the same way as a travel diary is interesting. I can at least say, here's the world that awaits you if you're ever penniless. Someday, I want to explore that world more thoroughly. I should like to understand what really goes on in the souls of plongeurs and tramps and embankment sleepers. At present, I do not feel I have seen more than the fringe of poverty. Still, I can point to one or two things I've definitely learned by being hard up. I shall never again think that all tramps are drunken scoundrels, nor expect a beggar to be grateful when I give him a penny, nor be surprised if men out of work lack energy, nor subscribe to the Salvation Army, nor pawn my clothes, nor refuse a handbill, nor enjoy a meal at a smart restaurant. That is a beginning.
One of somebody or other said, why are you standing on your head? And he said, you're noticed more if you stand on your head than if you're right way up. And that's a remark that we've always remembered because it was so typical of Eric. The Blairs, I suppose, probably hadn't been at Rose Lawn very long then, and he was looking around to see who he could pick up, and he picked up us.
It always seems to be summer when I look back. I can feel the grass round me as tall as myself, and the heat coming out of the earth, and the dust in the lane, and the warm, greeny light coming through the hazel boughs. I can see the three of us trailing along, eating stuff out of the hedge, with Katie dragging at my arm and saying, "Come on, baby." I was rather an ugly little boy, butter-coloured hair which was always cropped short except for a quiff in front. I don't idealise my childhood, and unlike many people, I've no wish to be young again.
The principal thing started in his place in the home. He was lonely. If he'd had a brother, he'd have been much happier. And then there wasn't a great deal of harmony in his family, between his parents, and he grieved over that.
Mr. Blair wasn't with his family in the early years. He was still out in India when the family came back to England. That Eric, I think, had hardly seen his father at all until he was about eight or so.
He was a very reserved kind of man.
A very, very reserved sort of man. And rather the sort of children should be seen and not heard and keep off the flower beds kind of a man.
As a very small child, I used to imagine I was, say, Robin Hood, and picture myself as the hero of thrilling adventures. But quite soon my stories ceased to be narcissistic in a crude way, and became more and more a mere description of what I was doing and the things I saw. For minutes at a time, this kind of thing would be running through my head. He pushed the door open and entered the room. With his right hand in his pocket, he moved across to the window, etc. This habit continued right through my non-literary years. I seemed to be making this descriptive effort almost against my will, under a kind of compulsion from outside.
Does the interest in the small boy you remember nearly 70 years ago surprise you? Did he seem to you in any way remarkable?
What, Blair? No, rather the reverse. Dull, uninteresting, unattractive. That won't do for everyone who's his fan now, but of course I only knew him as a kid. He probably became brilliant after Eton. Did he go to Oxford? No.
It's very difficult to get directly at Orwell because so many people have taken such strong and wildly different... But just that he was really such a scrupulous writer that he didn't want any distractions from his writings. He wanted people to read his writings, and he probably modestly thought that he'd led a very ordinary life, i.e. he'd been to Eton, he'd been in the Burma police, he'd been living among tramps, he'd fought in Spain, he'd been in the Home Guard, he'd worked for the BBC, nearly got drowned in whirlpools in Scotland. I mean, he really did view his life as extremely ordinary. I mean, confusing ordinary was simple.
From a very early age, perhaps the age of 5 or 6, I knew that when I grew up I should be a writer. Between the ages of about 17 and 24, I tried to abandon this idea, but I did so with the consciousness that I was outraging my true nature, and that sooner or later I would have to settle down and write books. I was the middle child of 3, but there was a gap of 5 years on either side, and I barely saw my father before I was 8. For this, and other reasons, I was somewhat lonely, and I soon developed disagreeable mannerisms, which made me unpopular throughout my school days. I had the lonely child's habit of making up stories and holding conversations with imaginary persons, and I think from the very start my literary ambitions were mixed up with a feeling of being isolated and undervalued.
It was to Roselawn that Professor Crick, Orwell's biographer, first came with Jacintha Buddicombe, Eric Blair's childhood friend and neighbour. Our film begins here too, with her earliest memories.
Where you see that rose bush, there was in those days a wire fence, and Eric was on this side of the fence in the field, standing on his head, and we were in the garden of the house the other side. He was standing on his head, and I think somebody or other said, "Why are you standing on your head?" And he said, "You're noticed more if you stand on your head than if you're right way up." And that's a remark that we've always remembered because it was so typical of Eric. The Blairs, I suppose, probably hadn't been at Roselawn very long then, and he was looking around to see who he could pick up, and he picked up us.
It always seems to be summer when I look back. I can feel the grass round me as tall as myself, and the heat coming out of the earth, and the dust in the lane, and the warm, greeny light coming through the hazel boughs. I can see the three of us trailing along, eating stuff out of the hedge, with Katie dragging at my arm and saying, "Come on, baby." I was rather an ugly little boy, butter-coloured hair, which was always cropped short except for a quiff in front. I don't idealise my childhood, and unlike many people, I've no wish to be young again.
The principal thing started in his place in the home. He was lonely. If he'd had a brother, he'd have been much happier.
That he gave English lessons, and that he found lodgings here at 6 Rue du Pot de Fer, once a working-class district in the 5th arrondissement. In the late autumn of 1929, he found himself short of money.
The Hotel X was a vast, grandiose place with a classical facade. I waited, and presently the chef du personnel, a sort of assistant manager, arrived and began to question me. He asked whether I was an experienced dishwasher, and I said that I was. He glanced at my hands and saw that I was lying, but on hearing that I was an Englishman, he changed his tone and engaged me. It was amusing to look around the filthy little scullery and think that only a double door was between us and the dining room. There sat the customers in all their splendour, spotless tablecloth, bowls of flowers, mirrors and gilt cornices and painted cherubim. And here, just a few feet away, us, in our disgusting filth. It is an instructive sight to see a waiter going into a hotel dining room. As he passes the door, a sudden change comes over him. The set of his shoulders alters. All the dirt and hurry and irritation have dropped off in an instant. He glides over the carpet with solemn, priest-like air. I remember our assistant maître d'hôtel, a fiery Italian, pausing at the dining room door to address an apprentice who'd broken a bottle of wine. Do you call yourself a waiter, you young bastard? You're not fit to scrub floors in the brothel your mother came from. Words failing him, he turned to the door and, as he opened it, farted loudly, a favourite Italian insult. Then he entered the dining room and sailed across it, dish in hand, graceful as a swan. 10 seconds later, he was bowing reverently to a customer, and you could not help thinking, as you saw him bow and smile with that benign smile of a trained waiter, that the customer was put to shame by having such an aristocrat to serve it. The waiter is proud, in a way, of his skill, but his skill is chiefly in being servile. His work gives him the mentality, not of a workman, but of a snob. He lives perpetually in the sight of rich people. He stands at their tables, listens to their conversations, sucks up to them with smiles and discreet little jokes. He has the pleasure of spending money by proxy. Moreover, there's always the chance that he may become rich himself. Between constantly seeing money and hoping to get it, the waiter comes to identify himself to some extent with his employers. He will take pains to serve a meal in style because he thinks he's participating in the meal itself. The moral is, never be sorry for a waiter. Sometimes when you sit in a restaurant still stuffing yourself half an hour after closing time, you feel that the tired waiter at your side must surely be despising you. But he is not. He's not thinking...
Nothing came in the way of his writing.
Not even people?
No, certainly not people. Not his family or anybody else, no.
He used to sit down at 9 o'clock in a little back room with a table and writing things. And he used to write till 12. And at 12 o'clock he'd throw everything down and go out and have a beer. Well, it didn't matter what he wrote, as long as he wrote. He was forcing himself to write.
I want to set down some general remarks about tramps. When one comes to think of it, tramps are a queer product. Tens of thousands in number, marching up and down England like so many wandering Jews. In childhood, we've been taught tramps are blackguards, and consequently, there exists in our minds a sort of ideal or typical tramp, a repulsive, dangerous creature who'd die rather than work, and wants nothing but to beg, drink, and rob hen houses. This tramp monster is no truer to life than the sinister Chinaman of the magazine stories. Why do tramps exist at all? It's a curious thing, but very few people know what makes a tramp take to the road. A tramp tramps not because he likes it, but for the same reason as a car keeps to the left. A destitute man, if he's not supported by the parish, can only get relief at the casual wards. Very little of the tramp monster will survive inquiry. A casual ward will often admit 100 tramps in one night, and these are handled by a staff of 3 porters. 100 ruffians could not be controlled by 3 unarmed men. It follows, then, that the serve-them-damn-well-right attitude that's normally taken towards tramps is no fairer than it would be towards cripples or invalids. When one has realised that, one begins to put oneself in a tramp's place and understand what his life is like.
He left the manuscript in my house, and he said, oh, take off the paper clips, but throw away the manuscript. And I thought, this is nonsense. It had been rejected by three publishers. So I took it to an agent in the Strand, Moore and Christie. And I said to Mr. Moore, will you read this and publish this? This is a good book. No, said Mr. Moore, I couldn't possibly. No one's ever heard of your friend. When we couldn't possibly take the risk of publishing it. So I bullied that man, and I left it with him, and I said, now you read it. And 3 months after, he sold it to Goldamps, and it came out. And on the day it came out, Orwell got £30.
What I feel the book represents is an enormous struggle to become a writer. After all, he told me that he wrote the whole of down exercising his wit. I think that his sense of the droll and his keen observer's eye, what I think Mr. Pritchard called the dilatory eye, comes through in that book, and that makes it a work of literature. After all, that really is the essence of his sociological writings, that they are literary works.
Ginger and I went to a kip in Tooley Street, owned by Lou Levy, who owns the one in Westminster Bridge Road. It's only sevenpence a night, and it's probably the best sevenpenny one in London. There are bugs in the beds, but not many, and the kitchens, though dark and dirty, are convenient with abundant fires and hot water. The lodgers are a pretty low lot. Mostly Irish unskilled labourers and out of work at that. We met some queer types among them.
It still is essentially a common lodging house, or whatever you'd call it.
Yes, basically it is very much that, a common lodging house.
How much does it cost for somebody to spend the night here?
It's, at the moment, £2.15 per night. And that is actually cheaper than other places.
But the conditions he talks about in Down and Out, what life is like for homeless people looking for a place in London, have they changed?
No, they haven't. It's got worse in terms of more people being down and out in London, fighting for less resources. The conditions inside the inside buildings like this, inside the residential hostels, have changed, obviously, in terms of the conditions that they live in. But outside, essentially, no.
At 6, we went to a Salvation Army shelter. We couldn't book beds till 8, and it wasn't certain that there would be any vacant. But an official who called us brother let us in on condition that we pay for 2 cups of tea. The main hall of the shelter was a great whitewashed barn of a place, oppressively clean. On a wall, pictures of General Booth and notices prohibiting cooking, drinking, spitting, swearing, quarrelling and gambling. Any man found gambling or playing cards would be expelled and would not be admitted under any circumstances. To my eyes, these Salvation Army shelters, though clean, are far drearier than the worst of the common lodging houses. There's such a hopelessness about some of the people there. Decent, broken-down types who've pawned their collars but still try for office jobs.
I think it stands up as a document. Of course, it is partly fiction. Indeed, as Orwell was such an autobiographical writer, one could say that there was an element of fiction in all his autobiography and a strong element of autobiography in all his fiction. Because in actual fact, the Down and Out covers only a few weeks in his life in Paris, and it's still a mystery. What did he do during his 2 years?
He disappeared from time to time, of course, and I think it was to do writing. He loved writing. He'd write anything for the sake of writing. But we never looked upon him then as a writer. And, of course, I think he rather upset the old girls of the town, because in London and Paris he mentioned his association with homosexuals, and it was very taboo, naturally. We made him a lot of flannel trousers over the years, in those days. I've got a record here, actually, where he paid 32 and 6 per pair of West of England trousers. Almost a working man's weekly wage.
He just turned up at home in his tramp's clothes. At my home. Much the amusement of the family of what was a frightful joke.
Was he ordered to have a bath instantly?
Yes, I said, you go and have a bath. I'd like to sort of feel he might shock you, you know, but of course he wouldn't get shocked at all. Well, I thought it was very unnecessary, but...
From your impression of him, he'd always wanted to be a writer.
Oh, yes, he was, from when I knew him, yes. I think he'd have told me, I'm not sure, I wouldn't be sure of that, but I'm quite sure he... And writing was the one thing through his life. Absolutely nothing came in the way of his writing.
Not even people?
No, certainly not people. Not his family or anybody else, no.
He used to sit down at 9 o'clock in a little back room with a table and writing things. And he used to write till 12. And at 12 o'clock he'd throw everything down and go out and have a beer. Well, it didn't matter what he wrote as long as he wrote. He was forcing himself to write.
I want to set down some general remarks about tramps. When one comes to think of it, tramps are a queer product. Tens of thousands in number, marching up and down England like so many wandering Jews. In childhood, we've been taught tramps are blackguards, and consequently, there exists in our minds a sort of ideal or typical tramp, a repulsive, dangerous creature who'd die rather than work and wants nothing but to beg, drink, and rob henhouses. This tramp monster is no truer to life than the sinister Chinaman of the magazine stories. Why do tramps exist at all? It's a curious thing, but very few people know what makes a tramp take to the road. A tramp tramps not because he likes it, but for the same reason as a car keeps to the left. A destitute man, if he's not supported by the parish, can only get relief at the casual wards. Very little of the tramp monster will survive inquiry.
He had those very early memories of it, which I think were glamorized. And that's why I think the disillusion of the East was so great.
Eric Blair left Eton at 18. Within the year, he'd enlisted with the Imperial Military Police in Burma. Meanwhile, he'd fallen in love with his childhood friend, Jacintha Buddicombe. Her rejection of him played its part in his determination to leave England.
Was he at all upset at your refusing to become engaged, or was it just something slightly playful?
I don't really know whether he was upset or not. He seemed, and partly from the letter that he wrote centuries later, when he wrote to me only a few months before he died, he seemed to remember all about it. And of course, going off to Burma by himself, he might have been more upset about it than ever would occur to me. You see, I never took him seriously, not from a romantic point of view.
In Moulmein, in Lower Burma, I was hated by large numbers of people, the only time in my life that I've been important enough for this to happen to me. I was subdivisional police officer of the town, and in an aimless, petty kind of way, anti-European feeling was very bitter. No one had the guts to raise a riot, but if a European woman went through the bazaars alone, someone would probably spit Betelgeuse over her dress. As a police officer, I was an obvious target, and was baited whenever it seemed safe to do so. Why did he go into the Burma police? It's a mystery, isn't it?
It's a mystery to me, and it's a mystery to his father, who wanted him to go into the ICS,
the
Indian Civil Service, which he could have done with the greatest of ease. He's a great classical scholar, and he would have got in very, very easily.
So why did he choose the Burma police, which is
an outpost, a grim job, isn't it?
A grim job in a real outpost, not like India, you see.
Why did he do that?
I don't know. I don't think anybody does know. And I don't think he really knew, except he wanted to get away from it all. This is my feeling.
When a nimble Burman tripped me up on the football field, and the referee, another Burman, looked the other way, the crowd yelled with hideous laughter. This happened more than once. In the end, the